Okay, today I'm going to share with you about the chi square, or in Malay we call it chi cos dua. So this is the general objective of my topic today. So this is about the normal curve, and this is about the chi curve. So if you can see here, the chi curve is determined by how many the degree of freedom, darjah kebebasan. So you have the lesser degree of freedom, so that's mean your chi will be producing more taller than those who are having the higher degree of freedom. So this is the chi values according to the degree of freedom. So chi cos dua is a non-parametric test for the statistical of the significance for the bivariate analysis. So we have two variables. It's either you want to compare between the groups, or we want to do it as a association test. Okay. So basically it's not like a t-test or variance test, but generally it's the same in looking into the distributions of the two groups. So chi cos dua ni is actually it's not the real data that they are looking for. They are looking into the proportions, or the proportion lah, the proportions of the data. Okay, so chi cos dua is actually started from the zero as compared to the mean and standard deviation tabulations using the normal distribution curve. We are starting from anywhere, which is we can expect it to have the curve after the zero, because the negative value also consider one of the element in the data analysis for normal tabulation. But for chi cos dua is actually we only looking into the startup of zero, and then the differences is about the degree of freedom. So the hypothesis is about example is like this, which is we can say that the IV and DV are not the same, or are not significantly associated, or we can say also IV and DV are significantly differ in terms of their proportions. Okay. So we go to the how to calculate the chi-square. So the chi-square is calculated by the sum of observed minus the expected times the power of 2 and divide by the expected. Okay, so this is the requirement about how you want to collect the data for chi-square. And then this is the table. This particular table is actually attached into this final slide, so that you can see about the degree of freedoms and the number of alpha that you are considered to be rejected or none. Okay, if you can see, generally speaking, you must understand about the five concepts of hypothesis testing. The first one is your null and alternative hypothesis. The second one is your alpha. The third one is actually you run the analysis, or you must have the justification to calculate your chi value. And then also you may want to look at your chi value, whether it's fall or do not fall within the area under curve. So if we can see that the area under curve is lesser than what we projected, then we reject null. And that is less than what we projected, then we fail to reject null. Okay, this is for example. Based on the darjah kebebasan yang diberikan, DG is 12, and then the DK 12 is here, and then our alpha is around 0.025. This is just for example. So the area under curve is 23.337. So that means if we calculate our chi value, and then we find out that our value is less than 23337, that means we fail to reject null. But if we find out that our chi value that we calculate after this, and then is more than 23.337, so that means we reject the null hypothesis. That means there is a significant difference in terms of the proportions between two groups, and so on and so forth. Okay, that is the example and some ideas about how we want to do this analysis. Okay, this is about the error. I don't want to talk about the error. And then we also got some limitation in the chi-square, which is the two cells, and then the expected value must not less count the 5. So that means if you have something that the expected count less than 5, so we can have some trouble. I took one example. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 cells. So based on this and this, we have this table is actually more than 2 columns, 1, 2, 3, more than 2 columns. 3 columns here indicate subject less than 5. So that means this table is probably cannot be used by the chi-square, which is violated the rule of thumb for the chi-square. whereby this one only have one column expected count less than 5, which is after we calculate the expected count, which is the expected count here is less than 5 is 1, right? But this one is expected count 1, 2, 3. So we have 3. 3 over 7. So it's more than 30%. Whereby this one, 1 over 6 is less than 20% of the expected count less than 5. So that means okay. Okay, so chi-square is actually divided into two different approaches. The first one is to degree to test the goodness of fit, and then the second one is the testing of the independence. Goodness of fit is similarly like you want to test whether the proportion is the same or the proportion is not the same. You have a standard, for example, and then you want to compare whether the proportions of the standard that you set and then the proportions of the data that they come out from your analysis is the same or not the same. So that one we call it as the testing for the goodness of fit. Another that we also calculate the chi-square to test for the independence. So the test of the independence is about to test the association. Is either x is influencing y, is the x2 is influencing z, something like that. So it is about the, it's similarly like macam correlation lah, but the correlation is talking about numerical data, but the chi-square is talking about the tabulations in terms of the proportion unit. Okay, for your information, the chi-square for the testing for the goodness of fit are divided into two different approach. First one is the standardized approach, and the second one is the standard approach. Okay, so the chi-square for the testing for the goodness of fit is actually, we must understand about the flow lah. So let us see. We got 6 player, and then we got 120 cards is already successfully being sell. So we want to know whether the tabulations of the each of the cells is similar or not similar. For example, so we have 6 player, and then we got 6 successfully card that able to be sold out. So we want to know the distribution is the same or the distribution is not the same. So our null hypothesis will be there is no significant, the distributions of the cat and the card that already being sold is similar. And then our alternative hypothesis will be the card that already being sold is not similar. So that is our null and alternative hypothesis. And then we focusing on our approach. So based on this approach, I hope you can try to understand about how we want to calculate this thing. So we got 120 cards, so we expect to have 20 cards of each cell, because this is the setara, the goodness of fit that is setara. We got two, right? Before this I already explained, we got the setara one and then we got the not setara one. So bilangan yang dijangkakan is about like this lah. So this is our expected 13, and then this is our observed, and this is our expected 20. So how I got this 20, 120 is divided by 6, we got around 20, because we assume that each of the cell will gather or will got same similar proportionate numbers. Okay, so 20 20 20 20, you sum up everything, you got 120. So this is the example of the calculations for the observed and expected count. And then this is what I said just now, and then we move to the second step. We identify our alpha, which is 0.05, and then we calculate our hypothesis based on this data, which is the expected is observed minus expected the power of 2 divided by expected. And then our chi minus 1 is the darjah kebebasan, which is k here is actually our group. So our cells is 6, so 6 minus 1 is equal to 5. So we need to find out the area under curve under the 5 and 1. So we go to this table. This is the last table. You will see the last table. We will find the degree of freedom 5. Why degree of freedom 5? Because we got 6 cells divided with 1, and then we got 5. And then we focus on our alpha, which is 0.05, which is 11.70. So this 11.70 is our standard that we want to compare with our values that we calculate manually. When we want to calculate manually, we go to the next line. Okay, so we need to calculate our data based on this calculation. So we calculate our data based on this calculation. We got the observed, we got the expected, we got the observed minus expected, and then we got the observed minus expected to power of 2, and then we got observed minus expected power of 2 divided by expected. So this is the numbers lah that we got. So we sum up all the numbers that we got here, and then we get 34.40. So what does that mean? Our indication for this is 11.05, and then our calculation is 34.40. So that means if we got something that is more than what we expect, which is 11.70, that means we reject our null hypothesis, because our value is actually go into the right side of the area under curve. This is called area under curve, right? Kawasan peranakan rejection region. But if you got, for example, like you calculate and then you got 10, so the 10 will be on the left side, so we fail to reject our null hypothesis. So based on this example, we got 34.4. So that means we are able to reject our null hypothesis and stated that the distributions of the card that already being sold is not the same. So that means the player are significantly influenced the cards that being sold outside there. So that is our hypothesis. So you can refer to the latihan and then make some judgment. Okay, actually you must know how to calculate this on the formula. Okay. The next one will be the analysis of the data for the not similar group. Not similar group. Okay, not similar group is actually the same like before, but we have the percentage as the indicator. For example, in this issue, we got how many times based on the previous study in terms of the percentage that coming to the hospital, and then somebody doing the same research, which is the different numbers that go into the hospital, but they are using the standard based on the previous study. So why? Because we just only want to calculate the expected. So for example, before this, people say that the first time going to hospital is 40%. So we take 40% divided by the 400, we got around 160. So and so on and so forth. So we got some estimation here. In the end of the day, our expected must also be the same. And then after we do the same thing, we calculate the nilai genting, whatsoever rejection region, so on so forth. Then we need to make a conclusion whether a reject or fail to reject our null hypothesis. So based on this, actually we fail to reject our null hypothesis lah, because our calculated area is this one. Our expected area is 12.592. So that means it's lesser than the kawasan penolakan. So we are saying that the null hypothesis is failed to be rejected. So that means whoever come into the hospital with a different times, how many times you go to the hospital is actually the same. So even though you come in 7 times to the hospital, you come in a second time to the hospital, whatever it is, you come into the hospital is the same. The rates are the same actually. Okay, the last but not least is the contingency table. So the contingency table is actually the principle of the cross tabulations to make a judgment of the association between two variables X and Y. So the principle is actually the same like before, which is we have the similar formula, but the difference is we need to have the expected count calculated in a different way. That's all. Okay, for example, we got some laju baris here. Laju is usually we put some problem lah, which is our DV, and then our baris is our IV or independent variables. And then this is how you want to calculate the laju and baris for the expected count. Okay, never mind, I will skip this one. Okay, I show you one example. I just straight away show you some one example. Okay, one example is indicate here lah. Okay, for example, we got symptom, and then we got two groups, yeah, yes and no. And then we got here is exposure, we got yes, and then we got no. So for example, we got 34 people, this one 32, okay, this one is 32. So how we want to do the expected count is actually, formula is very simple. Eh? First, we need to obtain the sum of it, sum of this, we need to sum this one, okay, this one also we need to sum it, okay, after we sum this one, we need to have this sum as well. So this sum is actually similar with this sum. Alright, whatever it is, I want to say it's like this actually. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, total. Okay, I think the time is up. I will continue after this.